Hello there, folks. Today we're taking a look at the game called London. It's published by Osprey Games. It's the new second edition of London, and the designer is Martin Wolves. So, as you probably know from the history, in 1666, there was a great fire of London. The city was devastated by this big fire. And now we are playing as architects to kind of rebuild this prestigious city and make it more prestigious, of course. And, of course, getting more prestige to ourselves as architects and trying to be the best as possible. So, anyway, let's head to the construction site. So, London is played over the course of several turns until this huge deck of cards is depleted. And then everybody will get the final turn and you will count points and see whoever has the most points is the winner of the game. You can get some extra, you can get some negative points at the end of the game. I will see it later. Anyway, the whole basis of London here is to maximize your every turn. I mean, maximize your play as much as possible. It's a lot of that resource management through the hand management as well, through card play. So let's take a look. So these are the city cards that you will... Everybody will have a starting hand of six cards. Anyway, you will have those city cards that you will play in front of you, basically by developing the city. Then you can also buy lands, buy those huge cards to get bigger bonuses, benefits. And eventually you will also draw cards, discard cards, and try to activate your city in the best way possible to get less poverty, which is negative points at the end of the game, and to get the most benefit points, maybe the money, something else instead of that. Anyway, so on your turn, you have four different possibilities that you can do. One of them, and you do one action per turn. So one of them is to just draw three cards into your hand. So there is deck A, deck B, and deck C. So the cards become better as the time goes by. Anyway, drawing three cards on your turn is a really easy thing. So that's one thing. The other thing, what you can do is to develop a city, and that's one of the main things. So, developing a city means playing cards in front of you, into the city, in front of you, from the hand. So, let's take a look at the card anatomy. For example, this is a really good card, it has everything. So, as you can see, this is the name of the card, of course, a beautiful picture. Here, this is the cost that you have to pay in order to play this card in front of you. In the developed city, some cards don't have that cost. But some have. So, you will pay that cost, you will play that card in front of you. Here, let's take a look at further anatomy. This is the activation bonus. When you run a city, when you activate the city, you will get this bonus right here. On the left corner, not all of them have as well, but that means that here, if there is something here, you have to pay that. For example, here means that you have to discard one card, whatever the card is. Then you can activate this card. And on the right corner, it's usually a solution to that activation or like a post-activation, which means that you have to... Usually it's turning over the card face down, which means that this card was activated only once and that's it. And quite a few of them have that. Some of them don't. And sometimes also you will get this small room here, which means that these are the points at the end of the game. So, some cards give you just straight points and nothing else. So, how you play cards, how you develop a city. First of all, as I told you, if there is a cost, you have to pay that. Second, if you play a card, let's say I'm going to play this brown or yellow, whatever, let's say it's brown card. Then, I have to pay one brown card from my hand into the discard. And the discard is basically this board right here. And depending on the amount of players, there are less discard spaces. But let's say we play a two-player game, so there are six spaces. First, you're gonna put them up here and then down here. So, in order to play this brown card, I need to discard one of those brown cards. It doesn't give me any benefit, but I'm discarding this. Which means that later on, when somebody wants to draw cards, usually when you draw cards, you can draw from the discard or from the deck or combine them how you want. So, that means that when I discard something here, I'm also giving the opportunity to get these cards for other players as well. So, let's say I play that. I can play as many cards on my turn as I want, as long as I have maybe money and so on. So maybe I want to play this one too into my city. Or let's say I'm going to play this one. into my city. I'm going to pay all the costs, and then I have to discard one blue one right here. So that's how you develop a city. That's really, really easy. You just pay the costs, you pay the cards of the same color, and that's it. For example, I cannot play this one right now because I only have this one and I don't have any other red card that I can pay it with. So anyway, the third option is to activate the city. And activation is also a really, really big thing. So when you activate the city, you can activate as many cards you have played as you want. That means that, for example, I can activate this one and this one. If I don't want to activate this one, I don't have to. Because usually when you activate those cards, as I told you, the right corner says that you have to turn the card over. So it's only once, and maybe this action right now is not beneficial to you. So, also I didn't tell you, when you play cards, you can play cards on top of the other cards. And I'll tell you why in a moment. Because sometimes you don't, like, each separate card or each separate thing right here, space, is considered to be a stack. And I'm going to tell you in a moment why it's good or bad. Anyway, when we get back to activating a city. So let's say I want to activate this card and don't want to activate this one. I want to activate this one, something like that. So when I activate this one, I have to pay one random card, let's say, okay. So it's East India Company. I'm going to pay one random card. Okay, I'm going to put it here. So to the discard. So I'm going to get 12 money. Really cool. Yes. Then I have to turn it over. It says here, then I have to turn it over. So it was only once, but it will stay here as a stack. I can later on put the cards on top of that as well if I want. So I don't want to activate this one, but I want to activate this one. Take two from each player. Take two money from each player. I'm going to activate this one. Even if there was a card beneath it, it will stay beneath it. It's not usable anymore. Okay, I'm going to take, let's say when we play a two-player game, I'm going to take two more. So that's basically it. Yeah, you got it. Now, the thing is, after you run the city, after you activate the city, you have to see if you will get any poverty. Poverty is bad because at the end of the game, you will still have certain amount of poverty, probably most likely, and you will get minus points based on the chart right here. So when I look for the poverty, I look at these things. I look at each stack that I have in front of me. One, two, three stacks. I look at each card I have. One, two cards. So a total of five right now. If I would have had any loans, this is also plus one. So loans, stacks, plus cards in the hand, that's how much poverty I get. So I have to take five cubes and get that poverty. This is basically how it is. How you get loan is that whenever you don't want to pay or you cannot pay for something, you have to take loan. You take this loan token, then you get 10 pounds, but you can pay it off at the start of your turn, only at the start, or at the end of the game as well. But at the start of the turn, you can pay it off, but you have to pay five more. So you have to pay 15 pounds for every loan of 10. So that's a bad thing. Anyway, that's how you run the city. The fourth action you can do is to buy those lands. And the cost is right here. And the cool part about those lands, some of them have the ability. For example, once per turn, exchange a card in hand with a card from the development board. This is the development board, so really cool. Also, they will give you one-time bonus right here. For example, I will get to draw four cards, I get one victory point, and I can discard two poverty. So this is how minus means discard, plus means add. But there's one thing. Whenever I activate my city, those icons are activated as well, and these are usually bad. So if I have this land in front of me and I activate the city, I will get plus one poverty. So that's it. But whenever you get a new land, you can buy more than one land. You will just cover the previous one and the new one with its new ability will be active. Some of them don't have any ability, but anyway. So that's how the land goes. That's how the game goes. So basically you're trying to maximize your turn. You're playing cards on top of each other. You're trying not to get too many cards in your hand, because if you run the city and you have so many cards and stacks, you will get a lot of poverty. At the end of the game, now how the poverty works. At the end of the game, whoever has the least amount of poverty, tokens, will discard of his party tokens. Let's say I'm playing with John and Jesse. Jesse has 8, John has 4, and I have 5. Which means that John will discard all his 4 poverty, and then Jesse and me will have to discard 4 as well, the same amount. So Jesse is still left with 4 poverty, and I'm still left with 1. So I will get minus 1 point, Jesse will get minus 3 points. And that's how you do. You will get also extra points for the money, for the certain amount of money. You will get minus 7 points if you haven't paid your loans off. So this is a bad thing. So, but eventually you will just, count the points. Whoever has the most points is the winner of the game. And as you can see, there is a stack of those land cards as well, the different ones that will go throughout the game. So you need to maximize when you will play the cards in this city, what to grab from this card, maybe grab from the deck, where to buy land, when to buy land, and that's it. So that's how you play London. So when I did the random unboxing video for London, I said that I really like the quality of the cards, of the board. I like the quality of components overall. So there is no basically issues with that for me. No, but there are some minor. Now when I got into the game, I looked at it further. First of all, though it's just very, very minor. Though I do really like that they have the insert, and that's really, really cool. I do like the whole box and thing. But the thing is that the insert is kind of functional and kind of not. I mean, it's great for the cards. You can put the sleeved cards inside. That's good. But those small trays for tokens, they are not so functional. They're really hard to get the tokens out, and they spill all over the place and such. So I'm not convinced by this insert. It's not the best one, but it's fine. It's still maybe better than nothing. So I don't know. It's fine insert, yeah. So then, also one other thing, I said that the cards here, really, really good quality. They're sturdy. They're really good quality. I mean, when you look at them. But there is one issue I have. Maybe you will see that. Maybe not. I mean, if it will zoom, as you can see, one of the sides of the cards wore off really easily. I mean, this is something weird because the other side of the cards is totally fine. I don't know what's the problem. Why only one side of those cards? But I don't know, it's maybe some production issue here. It's basically, you can avoid that by sleeving the cards, I'm sure. All the other components are fine components. The board itself, let's talk about the art as well. I do really like the paint style, the picturesque type of art in London here. Now, the thing about this one is that some people say that, oh, I want the first edition. The first edition is better because it has the board. Okay. Let me tell you what, I don't care about the first edition because it looks extremely lame for me. Now, don't get me wrong, don't just start blaming me so that I'm stupid or something like that. No, just for me, the first edition looks extremely bad. And that's where the second edition improves it for me. So I wanted to play the second edition because of how it looks. First of all, I'm not Martin Wallace fan myself, but That's how I got into this game. If not for the second edition, I wouldn't be playing it. I wouldn't be playing the first edition with the first edition artwork. It's just so bad for me. And the components, I don't care about the map. I do really like a lot of card games. I do like this hand management here I'm building up. And it's a little bit kind of like, it has the theme, it has this poverty, it's really It's interesting, thematically tied to its thing, because you're running the city, you're spending on the resources, which means that more poverty will be gained. That's true. That's how some real life goes, especially in that century of London. But it's also not as thematic as some big thematic games. I mean, this is the thing here. And yeah, I'm totally fine with that. Hand management, resource management, and so on. It's just, and I want to see beautiful cards in front of me. That's the thing. I like that. But let's go deeper into the gameplay and see if there are some caveats or if I do like the game a lot. Now, as I told you, I do like the all sorts of card games. I do like the hand management. And I do like it here as well. The cool part is that some cards are rather like good for points, but they're not so good for running your city, and you need to keep yourself up and keep yourself at the highest league throughout the game and get some extra resources, or otherwise you'll be just gone. I mean, for example, this Sand Paul's, it costs 8 to just play it. It gives you 6 points and nothing else. It just stays in your tableau and for nothing. I mean, of course you can put the card on top of it. If you will get the points for the cards anyway at the end of the game. So are they face down or face up? Who cares? If they were played in your tableau at some point, they will give you points. If they give you points, of course. So, but some cards, they don't cost anything to play them, and it don't even cost anything to activate them, but they give you some resources, but they are only one-time use. So there are interesting choices about. So I put a lot of those cards in front of me that are one-time use, and then I'm gonna activate the city, and then I'm gonna do the big turn. But also, I will get quite a lot of poverty because I have a big tableau. Then secondly, all the cards will be turned face down, and now I have to rebuild the city even more, rebuild my kind of tableau to get more of those cards to be activated, to get more resources. So it's very tight resource management, in my opinion, because you have to manage your poverty so you don't have too much. You have to manage your money so you will get enough money to play new cards, to play cards with points, but to also play cards with cool abilities in order to get more resources and so. And then also on top of that, in order to play each of those cards, you need to discard one card of the same color, which is really cool. So the brown cards are easier to play because there's a lot of brown cards, but there's less of those blue and red colored cards, but they're really cool. Some of them give you a lot of points. So you need to be precise. That's what I like. Also, what I like is that, for example, I realized that building, like, you want to do a huge turn, so you want to build a huge tableau and activate all those whatever 7 cards. But if you, like, the thing is that you will get poverty for cards in the hand after you run the city, for cards in your tableau as well, or let's say for stacks, which means that you cannot, the thing is that you will never discard the cards from your tableau. If you play them into separate stacks, they stay like that. And now if you create a tableau of 7 stacks, 7 cards or 7 stacks, whatever, then each time you run a city, you will be guaranteed to get at least 7 poverty. And that's a huge deal. So that's where the strategy goes. The way that I don't want to create a too big of a tableau, but it becomes of a tight race between players for the points, because you want to do big turns, but you don't want to do them too big, otherwise you will get too much. Yeah, but on the other hand, what I like about this one is that the strategy goes the way that you will get those poverty, and at the end of the game, whoever has the least amount will discard them, and all the others will discard the same amount and see what they have left, and they will get minus points based on that. So if everybody is getting a lot of poverty, you can do that too, because you'll just need to stay a few steps below that, the threshold of them having, like, say somebody has, let's say there are players, one has 10 free player gain, one has 10, another one has 9. If you have 6, that's already a lot. I mean, but it's 6 is minus 7 points, but on the other hand, they have a lot as well, so you just need to have the least amount. But if other players have a lot, you can risk and have a lot as well. So that's one of the strategies as well. It's really risky to take the loans, but you have to take the loans as well. So about the loans, you have to pay 15 back. If when you get 10, you have to pay now 15 back. But I mean, you cannot avoid the loans, in my opinion. Maybe you can, but you have to risk with that in order to win the game as well. Yeah, and also, you will get those big bioland cards. In the first game, I kind of wasn't sure if I need those, but now I can see a lot of benefit. On the other hand, I don't see much benefit because, Like, by the time you run your city, you want to have your hand size as small as possible so you will get less poverty. But, for example, those big carts, whatever the lands, they give you quite a lot of carts in your hand. So this is another thing to consider. So there is a lot of things to consider. This is a tight resource management. I do like that. I do like the variability of carts. I think if there even can be an expansion in the future that it expands it into even more, maybe variability of carts, maybe an extra mechanic. But it's a clever game. There's nothing that should be taken out of the game. I do like this discard ability. So you discard so the other players will have the opportunity to now grab the cards that you didn't want in the first place. And sometimes you have all good cards. So this brown card is good and this brown card is good. But in order to play this one, I have to discard another one. What should I do? What, you know? So that's the thing. And now let's get to a little bit of negative. Overall, yeah, I do like the game a lot for what it is. I haven't played it with two players, but I can see how two players should be fine because it's a little bit like a solitaire multiplayer game. So yes, there is interaction between interaction regarding the discarding the cards. Yeah, you discard the other gets, and some abilities on the cards let manipulate the other players. But overly, you're still building your own tableau, you're still managing your own cards, and it's all about maximizing your own turn. And you're don't really, at some point, you just don't care what the others do if you want to do great yourself. So that's the thing. That's one thing. The other thing is that there can be downtime because of that, because some players can think a lot how to maximize your turn the best way possible. And because this game is all about that, very tight resource management, it can create AP, analysis paralysis basically. And that's where we go further if we play it with four players, if at least two of them think a lot until your turn comes up. I mean, for example, when I played it, like, you can strategize, you can think ahead. Some players cannot. And if they cannot, they will have a really long turn. Should I activate the city or should I not? Should I maybe play more cards in the city? Or should I still buy this one so I can get list rid of two poverty, get the point? But here I get 1 point, but I get two poverty, which means I get -3 points. So, and you know, it's this one. On the last turn, if it's the last turn of the game, okay, I'm fine with that, maximizing your last turn. But eventually throughout the game, I can see how with two players, it will not lose the charm of being this management, tight resources and such, and still be fun playing with each other. There will be less maybe possibilities to screw over your opponent. I mean, like some cards that each opponent gives you £2. Okay, now it's not as good as a card, but on the other hand, I can see a lot of benefits of the gameplay being faster and thus more engaging and thus more interesting. So that's where I'm not sure if I would like to play it with four again. Three or two would be my sweet spot, most likely. Yeah, but overall, I've been talking about this game too much right now. I do like the components. I do like the art. I do enjoy this tight resource management and hand management and the mechanic of discarding and playing the cards and discarding the same color. So overall, a big thumbs up for this game. And this game gets a silver Wolf Reviews medal. I haven't yet decided what will be the name for the medals. Maybe Verzilla, something like that, Verzilla medal. Anyway, silver medal for this game. Thank you so much. We see you another time. Check out our channel, other videos, subscribe, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, Guild on BGG, anything. Anyway, see you next time. Bye-bye.
This channel is sponsored by Osprey Games. Check them out at OspreyPublishing.com.